Mike Black?
Here.
Erin Bevel?
Here.
Tom Lee?
Here.
The allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, and liberty and justice for all.
Okay, do we have any comments from visitors this evening? Next up is the consent calendar. And tonight on the consent calendar, we have our minutes from our June 10th meeting and non-public from that same meeting, as well as the minutes from the July 15th meeting, which was also non-public.
I think that we accept them as written.
Okay. Motion by Mike and a second by Tom. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Okay. Motion carries. Next up is our superintendent's update.
Thank you, Erin. Thank you, everyone. I love being in this gym because, one of the last times I was here, it was, paint now looks great, the pool looks great. It's just a wonderful, wonderful space to be in. My name's Lori Lane. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the superintendent for school district now. I'm retired after a long and illustrious career in education, and I kind of been doing a lot of fishing and a lot of just enjoying the things that people do when they're retired. So I wish him well, as he enjoys his retirement. So my goals for you, as I get up to speed with Rollinsburg and the business of the district, is to support your work. So to support Rich. Rich and I, we actually go way, way back. Rich and I know each other for 20-some-odd years. A lot of people don't know that. Rich and I used to work in the North Country together. Rich actually was my son's phys ed teacher. And son is a phys ed teacher, partly because Rich was in the world. So it's kind of cool that we're able to work together again. We've had a lot of good conversation. Rich has been up to the office, and he's met with Katie and Nancy and David and I, and we work to support the school and the goals as we get ready to restart the school year. So, as I was reading through his report, definitely wanting to support your goal, Rich, of rebuilding the RGS community as we come back into those. And also, Erin and I met a few times and looking to how I can help support you achieve the goals that we have set for this year as well. So I'm excited to get involved. We have a lot of great ideas, and I'm here, our staff is here at the SAU office to support you in any way that we can. Just a couple things. There's been a lot of, we're just talking a little bit about the IT type transition that we've been going through. As the two districts became separated and Rollinsburg became SAU Building 4, there were a number of systems, PowerSchool and the electronic messaging system, that were all integrated with the two districts. Now we've separated those. I'd like to tell you that it's gone extremely smoothly. It's not been bad, but it's been a lot of phone calls, lots of meetings, but we're getting very close. I mean, Blackboard's not quite ready yet, which is a frustration, but it will be ready soon. So we worked on PowerSchool, we worked on Mealtime, which is the food service piece of this, that Katie deals with more of at home than I do. The website, and I know Rich is going to talk a little bit more about that as we continue with the discussion tonight. All these things to help SAU 4 establish itself. And also for the data, to have that pure data. Sometimes we have to do a lot of manipulation of spreadsheets and things like that to make sure that our data, at least reported to the state and such, is pure and separate. So we need to, this all makes sense. It's just not always simple. So as we talk about the start of the school, which is coming up, students were back in this building on August 25th, which seems, for a while, it seemed like a long time from now. Now it seems like it's right around the corner, you know, and it'll just be wonderful to have kids back in the building. But it's not going to be quite normal. We are going to spend some time tonight talking about your reopening plan. And Rich will walk you through that. I'll be able to kind of tag team in that as I support those efforts that need to be put in place here in Longmont Grammar School Grade School. And I wanted to just close by mentioning a couple of the partners from the school district. There have been a few changes in staff, and Rich has communicated some of those changes. But one of the, you have somebody in your facilities director, according to them, in the district for a number of years, in his retirement. I'm not sure if he's a fisherman or what his passion is outside of his work here in the school, but I know he's passionate about this building and about the students in this building in town. And I'm hopeful that, as we transition and, that we can continue the good work and planning to help continue to upgrade this facility and make and, see his dream. So I know he always had all sorts of ideas about what he wanted to do. So I wanted to mention that. And then there was also somebody that's not here at this table tonight, who I've known, closer or not so close for the 8 years that I've been in the district, which is Judy Nelson. Judy has decided to step down from the board. And, Judy, again, like Dick, heart and soul in trying to make the Longmont School District the best that it can be. And I have utmost respect for the work that she's done over the years and navigating through, that transition to having students, that starting to move out of Summersworth into Marshwood, the whole SAU, separation, are just two things that I'm aware of, and I'm sure there are many, many, many more. So I just wanted to mention, my thanks to them and my appreciation for their work. I know neither of them is here this evening. We do have, he did a fantastic job of packaging up the clocks that we give to people when they leave, tired in such situations like this, just as a memento of the board's appreciation and the district's appreciation for their work. So we'll make sure that they get those.
Thank you very much, Lori. Yes, I even though Dick and Judy aren't here, I'd like to also say just a few words of thanks in public. Starting with Dick, during his many years of service, he helped us maintain our aging building and really help it limp along and keep going. And he identified so many ways for us to save energy and save costs. And it was just really valuable help that we really needed. And also, he was really involved with the kids at the school at recess and throughout the building. Very well respected by everyone, so we will really miss him and offer him our greatest thanks. And for Judy, I was hoping that she would be here tonight to hear a few words, but as Lori said, we are just really grateful for her many years that she served on the board, both as a member and as chairperson. She was always a passionate and thoughtful leader and really guided the board and the district through a lot of very challenging situations throughout the years. And during that, she's always been respectful and considerate of others' opinions and contributions. And if you've ever voted in this town, you have seen Judy out there in all weather holding her signs in support of the school district. So that's just one of the many ways that she's dedicated to the students and the schools in our town. So big thanks to Judy as well. Anyone else have anything to add before we move on? Thank you. Next we have the principal's report.
Things in my report and the reopening plan is later in the agenda, right? So
yeah.
I'll hold that. to give you an update on our numbers. They had mentioned in the spring that our numbers have fluctuated down considerably. We have a lot of kids from out of district. And the numbers going down did not include kids staying remote, did not include kids being homeschooled, because all of those families have indicated that their children are coming back. So we have had a number of move-ins in the last month, probably more move-outs, but as of today, we're at 136, so we've gone up about 7 students a month. We're hoping that we don't get too many more since we reached a classroom teacher last month. But our numbers in the class are averaging right at 17 per class, which is almost perfect. We've got 519 in one of our fifth, sixth grade classes, and a low of 15 in one of our first, second. So it's spread pretty equally across every class. So that's an update there for you. And our beginning of the year numbers will obviously be in the report probably next month. The SAU 104 website and your email addresses that get linked to that site. I was hoping to provide you with information on how to access your emails tonight, but I don't have that yet. So I will make sure I get that to you prior to the next board meeting, because our hope is that the new SAU 104 website will go live tomorrow morning. Tom will be coming in. Process to make a site go live. It's been done for a couple of weeks. We paid Caroline Carroll, our library media specialist, a small stipend to put together a cool site. I know Lori and the SAU have gone out to bid for some website design, because folks are doing your website as well. We just felt that economically it made sense for Caroline to do it. She's good at those sort of things, and she's interested. So it saved a little bit of money, and it'll look pretty professional. There might be a little bit of training for community analysis and the SAU, a different type of site to work with documents on, but if I can learn a little bit more, that's good. So that should be live tomorrow. Once it goes live, and we can tell that it's working, and we have our alert system about what that website is, but essentially it's www.sau104.org. It'll be great to move the site. An update on staffing. I was going to echo Lori and Karen about the invaluable is not the right word, but I hope there is the right word, because save the district. We've had to spend money in order to save some money as well, but on top of saving the district money, he's picked away at different projects throughout his career in this building. You walk into any classroom and you can point out, yeah, picture that. They're going to try to paint this whole gym rather than contracting people. So it just amazes me how much knowledge is departing us, and it scared me a little bit. Chuck is wonderful. He's done a lot of training over the last year. Maybe one of the lessons of the pandemic for us is that we have a lot of hands-on time with him, instead of being a night person and now seeing him. So we were really fortunate in that way to have somebody with some knowledge about projects and how to do things and how to troubleshoot little things rather than calling out every time for a service provider. So we're definitely going to mistake. This last day is August 24th, the day the first students arrive. We did that for this week because as tough as he might look, he's probably going to be a little emotional about it. For other staffing, our music teacher was finalized today. So we now officially have a music and movement teacher. He's actually coming in to meet with me tomorrow, and we'll get the ball rolling. new model that we're going to do for phys ed and music, and let him have a chance to inventory items and start planning for lessons. We have literacy tutor at the SAU level as of 4 o'clock this afternoon, so that position is now filled as long as the negotiating process is okay. So our only needs are a building aide, one mainstream coach, and a lovely 20-hour week part-time custodian. That's what I've been for 2 years. We may be able to fill one of those other positions before school starts. The other one might be a little bit tougher. It could be from September or October. But I'm feeling good about where we are compared to where we were last year, scrambling for staff and to manage both remote and kids in the building. And then the other thing I just wanted to mention, I quickly report that tentatively we've scheduled Wednesday, September 15th for our open house. We didn't do that last year for obvious reasons, but we're hoping that we can figure out a way to safely bring the families into the classrooms, into the building. A number of families have not been here for well over a year, and so it'd be nice to start the school year with my theme of rebuilding our community. You know, a big part of that is, you know, having families in the building with their kids. We're seeing, you know, the spaces that they're going to be talking about. But we're going to work on it and be a little different than in the past, so that we don't have to hear from families in the classroom at the time. We may sort of stagger it a little bit, but I'm going to kind of figure that out.
need to do them in public, if you are looking at, how would you describe it to me, you know, selecting and doing a vetting process to select a candidate for public office. So it does need to be done publicly. And, you know, and that's basically what you would describe as well. So, and then the term for this, and I'm sure you all know this as well, but you know, maybe for the folks that are newer, that the appointment is just from now until March. Now, I'm not sure, I think there is any final party for a term, is that true?
She was up in March.
Right. So if she was continuing on in the election and in March to finish her term, but since she's finishing her term, the election will be
Placed. Okay.
So, just to add that little piece for you. So, I think we would just need to know, you know, if there's a piece, you know, as far as helping to get the word out, you know, we don't want, if you want us to collect that information at the office, bring the information into us, and that process piece of engineering, or to you as the chair.
Yeah, the email is fine, and we've actually unfortunately had a few other boards in town recently. Stepped down, okay. So we've kind of seen the emails go out, and so I think we have to support it for getting the word out. And so I'll probably draft something up by you and then get out of there.
I also have the template that we use for regular elections. I can send that to you.
Oh, perfect.
That's, it's the same one we use every, you know, for the filing deadlines for the election.
Okay. Yeah, that would be great. I'll look at that too. Thank you. And then I think it makes sense for them to just come to our next meeting and we can talk to whoever's interested in the decision.
It would be nice to have whatever they submit to review it.
Yeah, I'll set a deadline for the next meeting. Okay, great.
Just so we have the respect.
Respect, yes. Anybody knows anybody who's interested? Serving on the school board, please help us get the word out. Next up is the RGS school reopening plan. So let's discuss that.
Well, I know Rich is going to talk more about the specifics of the plan. I guess my general comments are, you know, it's tough to be back here. It's tough to think that we're not on the other side. It was so encouraging, and I'm sure we all share this, you know, as people living through this pandemic, how, you know, June, good, going in the right direction, and, you know, all of a sudden, you know, 1 week it looked great, and then all of a sudden, it's not looking good anymore. So, what I think, though, with that all said, that what we do, we certainly take with me, and Rich and I are part of some of those conversations, and our others at the SAU office, our commitment to in-person learning, it's just that strong. And, you know, I think sometimes as we've gone through these conversations, you know, there's that concern that, oh, are they going to go back to remote? I think it would have to be an extreme situation to go back to the remote learning scenario. And so what Rich has put together is a way to safely, you know, come back in and keep our students in. And it has challenges. It has some of those same limitations of our, you know, masks. People talk about masks and talk about, you know, pieces around social distancing and things along that line. But we do believe that we can manage it now. We know so much more about what it is that we need to do.
So the good news is it's not 27 pages, it's only 16. And my plan is after it's adopted to do a cheat sheet because I think parents, they're not going to be able to keep this document, not after we run through this. So just the important bullet points of what parents need to know before we get into the year. So, like a 1 or 2 page overview. So those are the things I want to talk about tonight in the reopening plan. I've highlighted in blue, like I did last year, the new sections from the end of the year. And I've taken out a number of things. Took out the calendars from the beginning of the year. Took out a phase 4 description. So the big thing to start is masks. We started this discussion maybe 2 weeks ago, and at that point it was probably, if we're going to be okay, we're doing optional, and then all of a sudden CDC came out and the recommendations changed, and then over the last couple of weeks it really changed. And if you've been following the nation news, school districts have already started voting, and more than not have started sending masks for elementary middle schools and high schools that I've seen are optional. So our recommendation is for staff and students to mask, kids to use masks, and the biggest reason is because, you know, our greatest population aren't vaccinated. And we that are vaccinated could be carriers and pass it along to those who aren't vaccinated. So that's our reason. We do feel comfortable that we don't need our kids to wear masks outdoors this year. We held on to that last year, even though the guidance changed. We didn't want to ruin anything at the end of the year, so we told the kids that they had a mask at recess. And during the present class, unless they gave themselves a mask break away from everybody else. But we're feeling pretty comfortable that the guidance hasn't changed that way. So we would recommend making it optional outdoors, whether it's for class, or phys ed, or recess, a walking field trip. Allow the kids to make that decision, allow the parents to make that decision, whether they want their kids to learn. The distancing, we kept 6 foot distancing for the entire year, even though it changed to a 3 to 6 foot. So what I've told teachers is, for this year, try to distance kids to 3 to 6 feet. We had 15 kids in class at most last year. This year we've got 17. We have some better, more so we're not going to be able to meet with 6 foot distancing. So most of our teachers that have started setting up will see at least 3 feet, most of them 4 or 5 feet, just because there's a little bit of extra space. What they're recommending from a lot of the information that we've read so far is the layers of protection. So the mask is a layer, the distancing is a layer, crossing over and having, you know, multiple interactions with multiple different classrooms. We call it cohorting last year. So we do limit that anyways. So we'll start here without any whole school assemblies. Because in here it's going to be tough because it's 131 kids for the staff. Field trips. Last year in the spring, we did have some classes take some walking field trips in our community garden down the river. Just an exercise break on some of those really hot, sticky days like today. They go walk around with a lot of their class. So I think we can continue to do that. And meeting with the department heads of Rollinsburg earlier this week and the library directors there. Yeah, so, you know, regardless of what we did, kids were going to have a mask on us in the law. So that's something that's out there. Even if it's not law by the rule of September, I think for students, it's one thing to continue with that. And hoping that, you know, it's the same as the school district. So if that law disappears, I would recommend that consistency grows. So kids aren't confused. Keep that part of the protocols. Katie mentioned the hot meals are returning. That's a highlight last year with the ag budgets. So this year, we'll have hot meals again. Our frontline programs, we started in the spring because they're successful. For the families that utilize them. And we have our room back this year. We're promoting into the classroom. So we have space for fun time, more space for fun time. So we should be able to post ourselves again safely if they work out well. That's great. And then the other big thing, they are not recommending the temperature checks in the morning. So we've had some discussions, you know, initially, you know, trying to put the onus on parents, you know, to do, you know, the temperature checks, do the questionnaire with kids, and then keep the child on the first time. It's not like it used to be where, you know, no, it's just a simple, you know, it's just a cough. Surveys will need to be done. We'll take a lot of pressure off of the ALS itself. The state is not doing contact tracing, which means we won't have to do contact tracing. The language that the state is about is that parents, if there is a household member that tests positive, then the parents should be reaching out to other close contacts that they're doesn't help the school because you don't know who in school you're close to, but it's something that we'll have to keep an eye on. I got a feeling that Gail and I will do some control contact tracing anyway, just to make sure. The notification is still there, that's a requirement that we'll do anytime somebody tests positive that we're not aware of. So, I think those are the big highlights. The one question I had for the board, because I feel that my board can make this decision, is outside of using our facilities. I've already had requests by the Girl Scouts. They have come in the past and used space in our building for meetings. So what I told them was, not sure yet. They'll be back to me once we start and have an answer. The other two big groups that use our facilities regularly are the AAU program and the REC program, the basketball. So that, I would defer to you folks to make that decision. I don't feel comfortable just approving or disapproving. And I can go the way I think as long as we know that we're coming in with the safety protocols. All after hours, so the only people in the building will be able to do a proper staff inspection. And to the same time, we'll be just like we normally do. I'm not as concerned as we would have been a year ago.
to potentially come in contact with someone who has COVID without knowing it. If somebody has COVID-like symptoms, that we should have a negative test from them before anyone who's in close contact with them would come in contact with other students in the building. That was just my concern reading that. I don't know if I understood that correctly. COVID-19 risk factors.
And don't you understand that it's not highlighted? That was the procedure to follow for probably for a while.
So that's not something for us to discuss. It just jumped out at me when I was reading it for today. So I think out of bounds.
We can discuss it. I think we did discuss it back then and came to kind of an impasse about it.
What page is that?
13.
Rich, do you know if is that sort of the CDC guidance?
We took this from just as one thing to remember that if you're considering changing something to make sure you double check what the current recommendations are and making sure that the families know that it's a master layer that we're having to
speak. I think it's a valid concern. We did talk about it before, and one of the things we talked about then too is we can always be more restrictive than the CDC guidance, more conservative. We had talked about before, but also right now in the state of New Hampshire, you have all these people who have symptoms and they go get tested. There's only a 7% positivity rate, so that's 93% of the people that are getting tested. They don't have COVID. So, kind of what you want to do is there's the vast majority of people getting tested. We're in a different ballgame now. sign, you know, like that. So, and I think we talked about this last year as well. Phase one, full remote learning. We kind of, Tom wanted us to put in, I think it's a good idea, what are the trigger points to get there. I'm concerned with the wording on this just because it says significant community spread, which right now in our county, yes, we have significant community transmission for our state defines that as CDC. So I just want to be careful that we're not limiting ourselves because I mean, if you look at the data, it's less than a fraction of 1% of the state population that's actually impacted right now by this, by COVID. So I feel very comfortable with where we're at and the measures that should put into place. I don't want parents to read this and say, hey, we have a significant community transmission, I'm a full remote. And I know it would be up to the board to decide that, but I just want to be, you know, clear and on the same page that we all agree at this point. And I think before I used the word extreme earlier, well, that's actually, you know, you have moderate significant extreme, which I think Pulaski County is about extreme transmission level right now. So I just want to be careful with the words. I would be good with potentially taking that out altogether and just saying, governor, stay at home. That would be fine by me. But if you look at the other, you know, phase two, community spread is stable or diminishing. Somebody could always, if there is somebody who's concerned about this, throw that back at us and say, well, yeah, it's stable and it's significant. I'm concerned, so I need to arouse people's concern about that. I think you get my point. I'm comfortable with it, how it's written. You guys handled it very well last year. I don't want to get handcuffed by it.
That's a good point, Mike.
Yeah, I agree with Lori. I don't foresee us going back to phase one, two, or three. Unless there is some significant events. Probably more so than last year. I think there's so much more information out there. There's, you know, a larger population that is vaccinated. Unfortunately, in our school, there are close to adults, and none of our kids coming to school in 2 weeks are vaccinated. That's the piece that, you know, I think the schools are worried about right now, which is why the reason for the layers of protection. The only reason I kept the phases in, I didn't take them out initially, you know, we don't need that. And I thought, well, you know what? It's obvious. You know, who knows where we're going to be in October or January. You know, hopefully, you know, in January we'll be in phase five. I completely understand. You know, wording is everybody's got their own definition. That's significant.
And I can see what you're saying, but I think to take that out and replace it with something more specific than we're kind of boxing ourselves in. Like, I don't think we go back to phase one, which you know what you're saying, but if we just leave it at governor's stay at home order, that gives us no way to make that call ourselves if we feel it's necessary. And it has been made by the governor. New Hampshire is trying to make new things local so that we can decide what's best for ourselves. And I'm just concerned if we really felt that's where we should be and we don't do it because we took that language out and just said that only happens with the governor's handle. But we could modify it if you said extreme.
More of a difference between the phases or what the spread is like. And I kind of had the same thought, Richard, when I was reading this. I know you're going to make a cheat sheet, but on first reading, I thought, you know, we're going in phase four, and I think that's absolutely the right direction. I don't have any question about that, but maybe even to just gray out the other phases, sort of like this is in the past. It's going to stay in the past, you don't even have to read it right now, grayed out, or even take out, like
COVID, we do have to go backwards, then maybe then we have a more robust plan that has to be like brought back from the archives, just to, you know, remove ambiguity and not have, like Mike said, parents at home thinking like, oh, well, now this has changed to a new percentage, does that mean that we're going to change phase? And you know, what are the metrics? And there really aren't any firm metrics that we need to identify. So maybe that is an option.
Yeah, I don't mind taking it to the element. I just felt like, you know, we're not, the pandemic's not over, so we have to have some sort of, just, I mean, it's already there, but you're like, you know, this wasn't going to be part of the cheat sheet.
Right.
What I'm putting on there is, you know, I'm in person, these are the guidelines that we'll follow. And not even call it phase four. I'm just saying that, you know, we're going to be in person, there is not a remote option. Well, some schools are offering a remote option, but we're not, we don't have the capacity, we don't have the staff. And it's not just one teacher that can do it, because if you get kids from every grade level, which we have last year, it's impossible to reach seventh grade levels. So.
Problem is that this is, this, you know, virus is obviously just getting retarded. You know, if you're not watching the news and not paying attention, you understand why we're having this conversation. But I mean, every day is, we're just hearing these incredible numbers coming from different parts of the country. And we're heading into the fall. So people are going to be inside. You're going to have an entire population of folks who aren't vaccinated because they're not meeting the age requirement. So, you know, as much as I'd be the first one to tell you, I don't want to see these kids ever go to work. But the fact is, that needs to be, you know, much we don't want to talk about it, it needs to be on the table as an option so that parents understand that we're constantly looking at this. It's just like watching the weather every day. And if they don't understand that, well, you know, I'm sorry, but this is how we're going to keep kids safe. I think you're right, you know, with the wording, because obviously some people will read certain things into it, but I think we have to be as clear as possible as to the rationales to the why. You know, and if there is a governor's order, okay, but if there's something local going on where we're you know, just knee-deep in COVID, then that's a problem. We're going to need to address it locally. I mean, we're already seeing stuff at the hospital. We're already starting to see an uptick. It's not that hard to figure out. I think parents would want us to be safe. They don't want their, nobody wants to see their kid in the ICU because they went back to school or there was, you know, non-home awareness. I think we're doing the right thing. It's just, I agree though, you know, it's worthy.
I think that we do need to have this plan.
I definitely see your point, Tom. I think that we're all, you know, confident
Rich and the team are monitoring this very closely and we'll be ready to make the switch to whatever we need to do. But
if we just put the phases on the last page of the document, so that's there for reference for later on in the future, but it's not for the first page.
Well,
I think this goes to though, this is the reopening plan, and the reopening plan is based around the phase we were starting.
And that's all on the next page, that how it starts.
Yep.
Yeah,
I think it's fine, Rich, especially if you're gonna make the cheat sheet and that's really what people are gonna look at.
My plan was to link once our website, but we still have SAU pinned on the website. The SAU 104 website is different from our school website. So my plan was to get this uploaded to both the SAU and school websites. But I would teach parents, but within there saying, if you would like further information on our full reopening plan, please see the website. And not send this out every time, send out, updates rather than a whole page. But I don't know how many people that want some pages.
I mean, it's just a lot of information. I mean, my point about, that language, and it's that first bullet on all of those, on those first four phases, is that even something that comes out? Because those metrics are hard to, because again, as you said, and others of that go, significant community spread, well, by whose definition? And by what metric are you using? And is that really the metric? Because I mean, listening to the conversations on Zoom last year, and listening to the conversations that the summer's report had, and listening to other conversations, that those issues seem to be real, where people had a hard time because, things were going up, but we were still kind of, the phase wasn't necessarily changing. So there was kind of this disconnect between, that piece and what it was actually doing, what people were doing. So I think it's just a thought that maybe that comes out, and maybe there's some other reference to how the decisions are made. And I would also highlight too around, that goal, I think you talk about it, Rich, on the up next page, about the focus on in-person. And that's the goal, and how do we stay there safely, and I know that will be a part of the cheat sheet as well. Just highlighting that, so that like you said, this is where we are. This is what we consider phase four. We still have some pieces that we need to put in place because we're not done yet. We're not in phase five, unfortunately. But here we are, and this is what we're doing. And to take out maybe some of that language that people like it, the data pieces. And then let the team here manage that data piece so that, again, a small school has so many wonderful things about it, but one of the challenges is that staff members in this building, you are going to be looking at a different scenario. I think you were challenged with some of that even last year. So, so it's just something you want to make sure that you don't have words that people can get too much. And it gives you flexibility, but also gives you parameters to help people understand.
But, also making it clear that they have any questions to contact you or contact whoever you want as your point person, so that if they do, have concerns, that they can, rather than, stew over them, they can contact someone and say, okay, this is what this means.
Oh yeah, I had a lot of those last year.
But we've been doing this for a year and a half. This is, school year-wise. So, by now, people should know the drill. Coming into the school year, they're all hearing about the variants. They're just being safe.
Yeah, and to Laurie's point, I'm just looking at this now. If we struck the first bullet from each of the phases, you really don't lose much information. And it takes away the question. And it leaves the decision with, you know, the team that's making the decision anyway. Staff, maybe that doesn't even have anything to do with exactly what's happening in the community, but it affects the school and makes that change necessary. So that's
shaping the phases that we're not having to have, I think, the one that we don't have. We can make it more friendly.
So you're saying you don't like the, like, for example, in school. First of all, community's got a stable diminution.
Well,
or then three, community's got a diminution and a lower.
I think those don't say much, at least in my opinion. They kind of almost say the same thing. And how do you decide if it's stable or diminishing?
Well, is there any way, I frankly, like, they are, but is there any way that we could get a little more meat on the bone so that people can say, oh, I get that? Is there anywhere more, some way to more to validate? I mean, is there a way, I don't know what I'm trying to say, but you know, is there any way to get a little more specific as to, okay, these are sort of the metrics we're looking at, not without going, you know, there's a 2.5%, you know, increase, or not that, but to say, you know, based on, you know, current hospitalizations or number of cases in this town has increased substantially, rather than the number. Because obviously, if we're in that range, something is triggered, right? Something has triggered us to go to that. And it can't just be anything. It's almost like we don't want to say there's a number, but isn't that what we're relying on to go to that next phase? If we're going to move from 3 to 4, just as an example, if we're going to move from 3 to 4, what are we using as the basis to move from 3 to 4?
So we did have this discussion last year, and let me give you some real examples. We had 2 cases. In our annex, right before Thanksgiving, that wiped out all of our staff in the annex. So that changed our phase. 2 cases. Because our staff were either isolating or quarantining. So, am I supposed to put 2 cases? No, because that's one example. 2 cases, we've had a few times where there were hardly any
feel it's misleading to say we're starting the phase four and that first bullet says community spreads water out. It's hard for me to accept that that's what we're trying to do. We know that's not what we're after. I mean, the number of cases, just if you look at the country, we have for a time. But like I said, it still affects less than 1%, a fraction of 1% of the population, the state of New Jersey. So I really feel like boy, that would be a great recommendation. If you just get rid of that in mind, I would feel more comfortable saying, yeah, phase four. I mean, I'm all for phase four. I feel like it's just misrepresenting where we're actually at. Because it's not necessarily the community outside of what you said. How do we define communities? Or yes, we can talk about that before. It's not just families outside, it's where the teachers go afterwards, the communities that they live in as well, and how does that affect? So we're getting this kind of never-ending conversation. That was all that really jumped out to me. I think that this looks great, and thank you for all the additional work that you and the team have put into revising this yet again.
I'm just asking, does it still say contact tracing 10 minutes? Because they did go back to 15 minutes total length of 24 hours. That's like new this week. What's considered a contact?
state said they're not going to contact tourism. But if we have a case, we will still call them. Because the schools did such a good job of containing it to just household contacts, and most likely we won't have any contacts in school. But they still do, but they're sleepovers. That kid, that other student, has been in contact, or close contact. Even though they don't actually live in the same house, they sleep over there. So that they would be a contact, but they changed it. The definition of close contact is back to what the CDC has been saying, it's 15 minutes over 24 hours, instead of 10 minutes.
That's still in here under call number six under social distancing.
Eliminate opportunities for this to make exposure to
the
it's not about contact tracing, it's about the students. Well, like I said, it's about
15 minutes.
So 15 minutes in this connection. You can have a smart copy of some class today.
Mike, you have something else?
Yeah, kind of, well, definitely related. Not, I think the plan was good with the change that we talked about. Two questions. You mentioned we're not going to do temperature checks this year, so how regularly were kids actually turned away from these temperature checks in the last year? I don't know.
If they were parties because they had a hat on, they were running around, they'd sit for a while, then I'd reach out and they were fine.
I was just curious.
No, never.
I think that's a question.
Never.
Yeah. It was fun them saying hi to
them. I was like, so honored to greet them. I felt honored to be able to greet the kids in the morning. So
it was.
They got positive.
It was fun.
Yeah,
it
that was
fun,
that's the purpose one.
Yeah. We play music.
Thank you for that one. And then, just overall, what's the general feeling right now amongst the staff? I mean, are there concerns about where we're at, about the increasing cases in the country, the Delta variant, are there any growing?
I haven't seen the staff as much this summer, which is good, because that means they will fly into it and they will turn the ones that have been in and out the last couple of weeks, most of it is questions. You know, what are we going to do? So I've been able to help them with their classroom setup, but you know, I've really tried not to give the answers and finally this is what probably I don't sense there's panic. I don't sense there's there's probably a little anxiety. I mean there is all of us because you know our kids
would say that I don't think we can say yes to one and no to another. So I think if we're, unless there's some, you know, specific, you know, concern, because I'm sure these groups are concerned anyway. They have, you know, within their own meetings, they have to, you know, consider their gatherings or groups. Or,
she
nominate somebody to sit on that committee, but then I found out that it's really just a few meetings. One already happened, and then there's two meetings next week, and that's pretty much it for the year. So I'm willing to do that for this year if everybody's comfortable with that. And then next year, we'll have it on this in case anybody needs to go into the state. That okay with everyone? Do that for this year. So I will do that, and just I've been kind of keeping them updated that we have some things potentially on our radar for this year or next year. So I'll continue to do that.
You did do a CIP plan a number of years ago too, so I do have that document. I'm sure it needs to be updated.
But we do have
a spreadsheet with different tabs that have each of the pictures of everything that we had predetermined at that time. So we have a document.
That's our goal for this year, is to update, to really update that, because it's time. And we've actually checked off a lot of those items, some videos, which is excellent. Great, so I don't think we have a financial update until next meeting. So we're on to old business, which is the first thing is the second reading of the KEE policy on website accessibility. I don't think we had any changes on the first reading. Do you have any questions or concerns on the second reading of this policy? Okay. We will accept a motion to accept the policy as updated.
Motion to accept the policy as updated.
Thank you. Motion by Tom, second. By Harry, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passes. We are cruising right along to future meeting dates, and these are just our regularly scheduled board meetings.
With that budget schedule that you just looked at, the November 4th meeting, we will be meeting at 5:30 prior to this meeting for our first budget workshop on that morning. And again on December 9th as well, we have a 30 budget meeting.
Thank you. I was going to say we get to fill in those budget pieces. I think that's it for tonight. We do have non-public, but before adjourning, we'll take any closing comments from visitors.
So Judy was also the board rep for the wellness committee. So you may want to appoint someone else to fill those shoes. She actually did our time.
Is there anything that Judy didn't do? Thank you, Neil. That's a good point. Do you know when they meet again?
We will wait until September.
So like next week. That's not a bit far away.
It's a quarterly commitment,
yeah.
So okay. Three, 4 meetings a year. We've met a couple of times. Maybe we just make a call over the weekend. Pretty easy.
Okay. You just make a little more time on board. Anybody who's chomping at the bit to be on the wellness committee? I can do it. Thank you, Jared. That would be great.
I'm not going to, since the COVID vaccine is not required or mandatory, when it does become eligible for students, I can't demand that the parents submit those dates to me, but if they voluntarily tell me the dates, it's just for statistical purposes because the state has called and they say, well, what's the percentage of your staff that's vaccinated? It's just for them to be able to put on their dashboard, and it's always shaded, you know, what percent they have a vaccine now, too, not just the caseload, the positivity, the actual vaccine percentage rates on there. So I've not put up something to parents. It's not happening right now, tomorrow, but
right.
I will put something else to do. kids to get vaccinated. I would love to know, and, you know, I'm not sharing any names or anything, it's just.
Who does?
And there's, the state is paying for the SATS program, Safer at School Screening Program. They are contracting with ConveniMD and another vendor or two that I honestly don't think we at Rollins would need that. I know Summersworth is pursuing it. I think what happens is the vendor comes in once a month. They, after parents have signed consent, we would do like a drive-through, just like a food plan. They do just a very, what we call it, anterior nares, it's just inside the nose swab. This is for asymptomatic. This is just once a month, testing everybody, like UNH does or other staff every week or whatever. It's something to consider, but I don't think we need that. Summersworth has like teams. When you have like basketball teams, football teams, kids are more likely to spread things. And see, they pick it up asymptomatically. That's a great idea. I'm not so sure that we're not doing the intramuralism and things like that. We can talk about it more, but just that you see that SAS.
Yeah.
That's what it's about. If the kid comes to me, you know, the symptoms, but they don't want the symptomatic, they just want to screen everybody. They send it to, if it's ConveniMD, they send it to their own lab. It takes at least 24, they're thinking about 28 hours to longer PCR tests, if you don't have symptoms. But with the increased volume, like, you know, Salem, Manchester, Nashville, I'd see these big cities getting a good advantage of that. I feel like we would manage to just clog up the system more. I think we'd do a good job. Ooh, Rachel.
Okay.
We know about it.
I just have a couple quick questions. Rich, did you say we're down, you've one teacher less? Did I hear you at the beginning saying there's one teacher
yes.
less?
Yeah.
One less classroom teacher.
Yeah. And the other thing is if the teachers aren't saying whether they've been vaccinated or not, are they voluntarily wearing masks if they aren't vaccinated during the school year?
They're wearing masks either way.
Okay.
And you plan.
Okay, because I wasn't sure if you were going to have all the kids do it as well.
Yeah.
All right, thank you.
I'm sorry, can you say your name?
Nancy Dayon, Rollins Road.
Good news, Rich, for your planning for next summer. The rec committee is trying to move forward with Camp Rollins, so I decided to start thinking about dates and stuff like that. They'll be in touch with you as well. We're trying to get everything lined up so that it comes back for us.
It's January or so that I got quite a
few in the
past.
Yeah, we'll keep you in the loop for sure. If you know anybody that wants to join the rec committee, please.
Hey, we're trying to recruit for school.
That's our school board.